Hi, this is John Williams. Welcome back. Today we're going to talk about CMS deployment and all the patterns and the options around how to deploy your CMS. Doesn't sound like the most interesting of subjects, but actually it is the most important thing when it comes to content management. It is how you get your content from your systems all the way to your customer. Now, in the traditional world, in the old world CMS that we've been talking about, there are two options. There is the baking approach and there's the frying approach. And believe me, they have nothing to do with cooking. Following on from that, we'll go through the more modern day architectures that are out there based on Mac, based on headless, and some of the other front-end technologies like React and Vue, you know, the SPAs, and a whole bunch of other patterns. Now, we won't go into huge amounts of detail on these. We'll cover that in another episode. But what we will do is talk through how they work, what the benefits are, and what value is in these are in these different models and why you should use them and at what time. Right, let's start at the traditional CMS. And if we summarize what we learned last time around the CMS architecture, we can define the architecture as some simple components. First of all, we have the database, which we'll call the content repository. That's where all the content is stored. The content is placed into the repository by business users using a business UI. So they author the content and push it into the repository. It goes through a workflow and a process. Finally, out of the repository, the content pushes into a runtime, which transforms that content through libraries, SDKs, and templates into a HTML page. And it was a HTML page back in the day because that was the only way that you really received content. We didn't have native apps then. Let's look at it from a workflow perspective. First of all, the content is submitted by the business users using a business UI into the content repository. And that's the authoring process. And it goes through a whole bunch of cycles until they get the content right. Once it's ready, the content is then pushed through a publishing workflow, a publishing process that takes it from that draft environment, from the business UI, all the way into the live environment. And then once it's in the live environment, the content is deployed from the system into the browser or native application in the modern world to the actual customer. Now let's get back to the actual approaches. So we talked about baking and we talked about frying, but I didn't tell you what that actually means. So let's work it out with those core components and that workflow, what baking and frying actually means. Okay, let's start with baking. Well, baking is probably the most simplest one. In baking, what actually happens is obviously the UI stays the same. The business user submits content into the UI, goes into the repository. But what's different here is that during the publishing process, what actually happens is that the runtime sits in the publishing process and actually generates static HTML pages and then pushes it onto a delivery environment like a set of web servers. Once it's on the web servers, it's then carried on and pushed to the browser and the customer from the web servers itself. So the CMS actually stops after the publishing process. The CMS actually provides the platform for templates, the platform for the runtime, all to generate basically a static environment, to basically generate static web pages. And this is excellent for performance because it's just static HTML being pushed up to the browser. It's great for scale because you only have to scale some web servers. It's great for security because what are you going to break into? Just a set of static HTML pages. You don't actually have access to any of the database underlying or any of the underlying technologies. So that covers baking, which means content is baked into static HTML during the publishing process. But what is frying? Well, frying is slightly different. Frying is more dynamic. What actually happens is that content, once it's submitted into the repository, during the publishing process, the content isn't baked out into static HTML. What is actually happening is content in the repository is moved technically from one repository, which is used for the author environment, into a live repository. Once it's in the live repository, then you have a runtime that dynamically accesses that content, generates the content on the fly into HTML. So once a customer accesses a web page, it sends a request to the CMS. The CMS then takes that request, pulls the content from the repository, pushes it through its runtime, the SDKs, it takes all the developers' templates and all of the presentation logic, and then generates a HTML page at the end of the day and pushes it to the browser all dynamically. Now, that's great if you want lots of flexibility, if you want to join in other systems and have a more dynamic environment, but you have the downsides around scaling and performance because you have to put a lot more into it because you own a lot more of the infrastructure. And the CMS actually takes over much more of that vertical integration all the way from the business user to the endpoint that generates the HTML to the customer itself. So what did I actually think in terms of implementing these technologies? I've done both of them for over a decade in the past. Well, baking is much simpler to run as a project, and you didn't need as many different types of developers as what you did for frying, that's for sure. And it was easier to kind of get out, although you could have still big projects that took a lot of effort, but the complexity was usually less because you were dealing with templating, and the sophistication was in the creative and making sure the templates rendered what you really wanted at the other side. And when you come to the frying solution, you used a lot more in terms of the types of developers. You needed a different range of developers all the way from front-end and JavaScript as you'd need in the baking solution, all the way down into the specialist CMS and the specialist back-end developers. And you would have a lot more complexity in the development, but that usually came because you wanted a richer site that was more dynamic, that you're adding other types of systems into the mix. So you got a more interesting and more dynamic environment, but there was a lot more sophistication and complexity in terms of the development. So it really came down to what you wanted. So what about the new world? I'll go through three approaches in the new world, but I'll briefly go through them because it needs an entire episode to do it justice. First of all, we have the SPA, or single page application. In this simple deployment pattern, it's pretty much the same as frying in the old CMS, except for one key difference. In the SPA approach, in the headless CMS approach, there are no templates and there are no runtime. It's just an API that delivers JSON. And that JSON, that content delivered as data, is pushed into an application which sits on the browser. So it's a client-side application that makes API requests back to the CMS that's pulling content out of its content repository dynamically and feeding it back to the application. The key difference here is that it's not HTML that's sent from the CMS, it's content as data. So there is no rendering done by the CMS, everything is controlled within the application. The advantage that the SPA has over the frying solution is it can be much more performant if it's coming from a true cloud-based CMS. It also can deliver to any device and any channel because it's not restricted by the HTML. And you also get the scaling that comes with cloud. The downside is that with a pure SPA, you may have issues around search engine optimization, so the SEO aspects. So the second modern approach I want to discuss is server-side generation, SSG, which is actually no different to the baking solution from a very high-level perspective. Where it differs is that the CMS doesn't do the server-side generation. The CMS, the headless CMS, is still delivering content through an API. What you have is a whole framework, a whole application, that deals with the server-side generation of pages and puts a lot more automation around it, allows you to do a lot more around incremental deployments, and it also allows you to choose different templating technologies, or you can even choose an application framework like Vue or React instead of just simple templating. So you can build it in your application of choice and then server-side render it. And there's a lot more options around it, but from a very high-level perspective, it's pretty much the same as baking, except you have a dedicated framework for it, and you've got much better choices around the actual frameworks and the templating that you use. So you get pretty much the same benefits as what you get from baking, but you get in the new headless world. So better performance and scale and security. And that brings us to our final approach, which is server-side rendering, SSR. And then to understand server-side rendering, we've got to go back to SPAs. So SPAs are client-side rendered. And what happens there is that when you request a page, it will then download the React or Vue application. It will then execute it. That will then build the pages. And during that time, it will start loading content through APIs. So it is super fast in terms of the API calls. And once you're running through the app, because you're loading smaller pieces of content through the APIs, but that initial load can have a bit of a lag. Or in terms of SEO, it's not quite as performant because it prefers kind of a statically rendered page. However, with server-side rendering, what happens is the application generates a static version, a HTML version of its page, and sends that to the browser. The browser will load that content, and then it will download the React app or the Vue app or whatever app you've got in the background. And once that's loaded, it will execute it, and then the page becomes interactive at that point. So what you get is a much faster load time, so first time to byte. It does the same process pretty much in terms of the application loading and executing, but the performance is much better for a user because you get that initial load much more quickly and you get the added bonus that your SEO will be much better, much more performant than what it would if it's just a standard SPA. And that's all we have for today. We covered quite a lot there. We covered the traditional CMS approaches of baking and frying. We even covered some modern day approaches. We covered three of those. There's a lot more out there, but we covered the three main ones, which is client-side rendering, and we covered server-side generation, as well as server-side rendering for those isomorphic implementations. We'll go into modern day architecture deployments in future episodes. Let me know what you think and what you'd like me to talk about. Please provide comments, ask some questions, I'll get back to you. Don't forget to like if you really enjoyed the episode. And don't forget to press that subscribe button before you leave. But for now, just to say thanks and goodbye, and I'll see you in the next episode.